So the state of the art of quantum computing is actually a very interesting question. On one hand, we have dedicated quantum simulators, and those are devices where you basically, you try to think of something that you want to understand, and then you build that same thing, and then you make a measurement to understand it. It's kind of like a quantum wind tunnel. Then you have kind of different levels of programmability and different levels of precision and control. The highly precise precision and control devices are coming from IBM. These are around 50 qubits. The highly programmable devices, which are some form of simulator as well, are coming from D-Wave Systems. Those are around 2,000 spins, and those are called annealers. You want to understand, and a lot of people want to understand, well, what is the relationship between big data, between computation, quantum computation? How does it all fit together? And it's actually interesting. So first, you don't know where innovation is going to come from. The transistor happened because they got research and development to make the hearing aid. Okay, and that spawned the computing industry. Now, quantum big data is very big data. A quantum state is very difficult to kind of understand and to study because of the fact that, you know, it's a quantum mechanical state, and it in principle can take, you know, many different degrees of freedom to describe that state. Now, in terms of using a quantum computer to solve data analysis problems, there's many different quantum subroutines that can work in tandem with a classical computer. The interesting thing about quantum computers right now is you always hear about, you know, IBM has 50 qubits, okay? Rigetti has 19 qubits, okay? D-Wave has 2,000 spins in an annealing quantum system. Okay, you always hear about that, and soon we're gonna start hearing more and more about how these qubits are being used to solve practical kind of questions. Now, we're right on the threshold between kind of the research lab and these really big industrial applications. And the classical world of computing first started in the university lab, and it sort of rapidly became part of industry. It was the same kind of scenario that we're living in right now. And the impact, you know, when it does happen, it's irreversible. It's unchangeable. We won't be able to ever go back to the point, you know, that we are at today. The types of things that these machines will open up will be really a new form of electricity, or it's like the laser is to the light bulb. It's something really different. These quantum machines are now kind of, they can be viewed in some way as a black box. And I think that's really a profound kind of model of computation, where now the classical computer programmer is able to access these machines. And I think that the impact of that in the short term will be very shocking, and in the long term will be very profound. Like, our data analysis centers will start to be filled more and more with, at first, kind of a programmable quantum wind tunnel, and then eventually a general purpose quantum computer. One of the things about trying to imagine the future is that it's very hard, because the future is unknown. And the interesting thing is that your time right now and what you say right now correlates to the future. So you can change the future by talking about it. Right? This is like Cassandra, you know, the legend, you know, she knows the future, but she can't tell anyone. Anyway, so there's all these famous quotes from people in the early days of computing saying, someday computers are going to weigh less than a ton. Well, there's a company up in Canada, a startup company called Xanadu. Okay, and a couple of my friends work there, and they're trying to build a room temperature, potentially portable quantum computer. At first, of course, right now, these quantum computers, they have to be cooled down to a very, very low temperature. Have a portable one, I don't know if we need one, I don't, you know, right away, but in the long term, I think companies like Xanadu are going to, they're going to look at different applications of quantum technology, they're going to do it at room temperature, and this will lead to more portable electronics that incorporate different aspects of quantum effects. And so we're probably closer to that than we first thought.